Hi, it's Carl with Imply. Your analytics application needs to deliver a lot for your users. It needs to be interactive, sub-second query response at any scale. You need to support hundreds or maybe even thousands of concurrent users. You need to bring in real-time data, true real-time data, and it needs to be resilient and flexible enough to survive everything. It sounds like a tall order for just one database. So let me show you how Druid does it. When you set up a Druid cluster, there are three basic node types that you need to take care of. First is the master node, which is responsible for the overall health of the Druid cluster. There are query nodes, which are responsible for parsing and delivering query results. And then the data is going to be stored on data nodes. And in this example, I'm going to draw three data nodes. By the way, you don't have to have three. You could run all of this on one physical server if you want to, or you can have thousands of nodes if your needs require it. But data is going to be stored on these data nodes. And underneath all of it is going to be a deep storage layer, which could run in the cloud, for example, on something like S3, or if you're going to run this old school, maybe you'll run this on-premise with Hadoop to act as your deep storage layer. These are the basic building blocks of a Druid cluster. Now, data comes in a very wide denormalized table, usually keyed by time. And when data comes in, it's stored on the data nodes in segments. And segments are files. And depending upon the data that you have and how well it can be compressed, these could be maybe a couple million rows on each of these segments. But these segments will belong to that middle node there. And every data segment has the same characteristics in Druid. They are columnar, which is good because columnar is the best structure for an analytics database, because if you only need to query some of the columns instead of all of them, it just retrieves only those columns. Columnar databases are also excellent with compression. So every one of the segments here is compressed to save space and make it more efficient. And everything is also automatically indexed. And the index is stored right there on the data segment along with the data. Now, many other databases, in particular some of the bigger cloud data warehouses, don't even have indexes at all. And that kind of hurts your interactivity. We create the indexes automatically for you. You don't have to worry about it. They are part of the data segment. Segments are also automatically replicated. So let's say we have these three segments here, and these segments will be replicated at least once to a different node, if that's what you've got. Now, this is done obviously for fault tolerance purposes, so in case we lose a segment, it's available on another node, but it can also be used to improve the interactivity and the query performance as well, and that's something that the query server will take care of. So, the other thing you have to think about here is how you're going to partition your data across segments. And this could be a video all on its own, but what you need to know for now is that you can pick one of several different partitioning schemes, where maybe the partitioning would happen across multiple different segments like this, which is excellent for write operations to spread it out so there's no contention when you're writing data. But that wouldn't be a very good choice for querying data, where you might actually want to create kind of a hotspot of all the records that you need in one place so that when you run the query, it just has to go there to get what you're looking for. In any case, you don't have to pick one extreme or the other. In fact, we have a multi-dimensional range partitioning option, which lets you pick an arbitrary set of dimensions to partition your data on so you get exactly the right partitioning for the kinds of queries that you expect your users to ask. All right, once you've got this all set up, we just need to ingest some data. So data ingestion can happen for Druid two major ways. So we'll bring data in to the data nodes here. Of course, like every other database out there, we can do data in batch from various files, or for real-time data, we can bring in data from the Kafka API or Kinesis. We support these things natively, no connector needed. Now, when data comes in, you can also optionally do a rollup on it. And a rollup is just a mathematical operator that aggregates data, summarizes it for you. For example, let's say you have a website where you have events coming in through Kafka every second. but you really don't need to report on something that happens every second. Maybe you only need to report by the minute or maybe by the hour. You could roll that up by the minute. What that does is a couple things. It helps with interactivity because when you run the queries, well, the data's already been aggregated to some extent and it's ready to go. But it also reduces the amount of data that you need to store on the segments, which saves you money, saves that storage. So rollups are optional. You don't have to do rollups. If you want all the glorious by the second data in your data warehouse, you can certainly do that with Druid, no problem. The other thing that happens here during data ingest is data is brought in to the cache, memory cache on the data nodes. I'll draw a little old school memory chip, the kind that I used to plug into PCs back in the day. We're talking the late 80s here. When data comes in, it's held in cache while all of these things happen to it. Columnarized, compressed, automatically indexed, and partitioned. Now, the cool thing about true real-time ingestion, not only do we natively support Kafka's API and anything else that uses Kafka's API as and Kinesis, but when real-time data comes into the cache, you can actually query it while it's there. We call it query on arrival. Everybody else has got to wait for the data to be sorted out and put onto storage or maybe even persisted to deep storage. Not Druid. That data is available in true real time the moment it arrives at the query. Well, once all of this stuff is done to a data segment and it's ready to go, it is then committed to deep storage. Here's where we get to talk about resiliency. Because with data in that deep storage layer, that basically frees up the data nodes. So if you decide that you want to add another data node, other databases, you're going to have to rebalance the cluster, rebalance the segments or the shards or whatever they call them. And it's a manual task that can take hours or even days to do, bringing the system down to do it. Not so with Druid. Because we have data here in deep storage, if you add a node, we can use that data from deep storage to rebalance the cluster automatically. Or maybe one of the nodes goes down, and maybe even the one that has the replica goes down too. Oh no. Well, with data in deep storage, we can rebuild that cluster and rebalance it again automatically, leading to a very excellent resiliency results here. Well, as you query data, queries come in from the application, the query server is going to prune that data, figure out what data nodes it needs to call. Let's say it figures out that the data you need is here and here. Then it will scatter the query to the appropriate data nodes. The data nodes will respond to the query, send the data back. The query processor then aggregates the data and sends it back up to your application. Well, that's how Druid works in just a few minutes. What we should do now is go back to our checklist and see if we have met all the requirements. Well, interactivity. You'll notice something here about this Druid architecture. It really has the best of both worlds that we've been used to in the analytics business for so long. We know that for interactivity, the best kind of architecture is going to be a shared nothing architecture where the data nodes have the data local to them so that you're not jumping back and forth to storage like you do with a cloud data warehouse, for example. Local storage. That's the best you can get for interactivity. But at the same time, we also do the separate storage and compute that some of the big name cloud data warehouses do as well, so that you can get the automatic rebalancing or add a node, remove a node, and not have to worry about it. So we get the resiliency as well. So just this architecture alone is already meeting so many of the requirements that we need for a really good analytics application. So for interactivity, we have the local shared nothing storage at the data node layer. We're columnar, we're compressed, we're automatically indexed across those segments. And that is how you get sub-second response at any scale. Concurrency, because we can scale out this architecture at any layer. That helps you with achieving high concurrency because scaling out is how you get concurrency, not just merely scaling up a database. We talked about how you can query data when it's in the cache, query on arrival, and how we support the Kafka API natively in Kinesis, and that's what leads us to true real-time. And then, of course, we've talked about the separation of storage and compute, which gives us the resiliency and the flexibility that you need to make sure this application is running no matter what happens. So there's very few databases out there that can do all of this in one place. The fact that we have the best of both worlds architecture, the fact that we don't have to do caching like so many cloud data warehouses have to do, constantly caching data from the storage layer up to the query layer. We don't need to do that. The data is already there, yet it's also here. So there's very few databases that have this kind of flexibility and this kind of power in one spot. So I hope I made it intriguing enough that you want to take a closer look. And maybe you do want to try it out, but you're looking at this diagram and you're saying, hey, Carl, it looks like there's kind of a lot of boxes there. I don't know about this. I want to try it out, but maybe I don't want to be an expert in all of this yet. Well, I've got an idea for you. You could try running Imply Polaris, which is our Druid as a service offering. You could have this up and running in minutes with a free trial and not have to worry about all that infrastructure. Later on, if you decide that you do want to run this in your own cloud and you want our help, of course, we can do that for you as well. Well, I hope this was an interesting whiteboard session. Thanks for your time, and I look forward to seeing you around the Druid community.